Good morning and welcome to Pekin First, where we exist to unite everyone with the life-giving power of Jesus. This is Unite Youth Weekend. We are so excited to see our youth leading worship this weekend. Joining me today from the youth room is Brody Bouchon, one of our Pekin First youth.
So glad to be here. I'm super excited for Youth Weekend.
This morning, Pastor Jim will continue the series on Religion Stinks. Let's check in with Pastor Jim and see what this weekend will bring.
I don't believe in a God who sends people to hell. I don't believe in a God who lets children die of cancer. I don't believe in a God who hates people who are different. I don't believe in a God who kills innocent people in hurricanes. I don't believe in a God who's against people of other countries. I don't believe in a God who answers some people's prayers but not others. I don't believe in a God who lets people starve. I don't believe in a God who lets people abuse other people. And I don't believe in a God who makes babies be born with defects. We could do this all day. It's so easy to state the kind of God we don't believe in. Let me set the record straight on this. Here it is. I don't believe in that God either. In fact, I don't believe that God exists at all. So, is there a God? That question is worth wrestling with. And we're going to hit it head on at Pekin First this weekend.
Thank you, Reverend Jim. Don't forget, if you miss a week, you can always go back and watch it on Facebook or YouTube or at PekinFirst.org.
The total for the Easter offering for the Dragon's Closet was $8,810. This is a great witness of grace flowing out of Pekin First and into the community. Thank you for your generosity for this project and showing how grace flows for everyone. Also, Unite Kids is ready for this Wednesday. Your kids can join in at 5:30 here at the church on the front lawn. Rock Kids is looking for volunteers. Find out how you can make a difference in the lives of children in the community Saturdays from 11 to 12. Comment below or reach out to the church to see how grace is reaching our community.
Mark your calendars for some great food and fun. June 12th is the church picnic. After Sunday worship, we'll have kids' water games, kids' face painting, and a bags tournament. Just bring a dish to share and let's have some fun.
Softball season is in full swing. Both teams will play this week. Game 1 starts Monday at 6 p.m. on Diamond 1, and Game 2 starts Monday at 8 p.m. on Diamond 2. We hope you can come out and help bring us on a win. Don't forget about all the small group opportunities, including a new small group called Powerful Parables for Your Life Now. This six-week study will dive into 8 mind-blowing stories that Jesus taught that potentially could alter our assumptions on life. This small group is available in person, in the dining room, or via Zoom. We also have other small groups that you can be a part of. For more information, check out our webpage at PekinFirst.org. As you can see, grace is flowing through Pekin First, and there are so many ways to connect. You can like, follow, subscribe to keep up with upcoming events and ways you can serve. You can also visit our website at PekinFirst.org and sign up for the Weekly Wave.
The Weekly Wave is weekly updated on news and events going on in the community of Pekin First. Well, I believe our worship team is ready to start worship. Today, the worship team will be leading us with In the River, Stand in Your Love, How Great is the Love, and The Stand.
We will also have a special performance of Brokenness Aside from Peyton and Stella of our youth. Let's go into the sanctuary where John, another one of our youth, is ready to start worship.
Thanks for joining worship today, either here or online. I'm John, and I'm part of the Breakthrough Youth Group here at Pekin First. This is Youth Sunday, so we're helping in various ways. We love being part of the church, we love to serve, and we're thankful for supporting in many ways. As the worship team leads us, let's all open our hearts and minds to the flow of God's Spirit as we sing In the River.
Please stand and worship with us as you are able.
There is a river where goodness flows. There is a fountain
that drown sorrow. There is an ocean deeper than fear. The tide is rising, rising. There is a current stirring deep inside. It's overflowing from the heart of God. The flood of heaven crept over us. The tide is rising.
Today. Good to see you all today here. If it's your first time here, we're so glad you could be here this morning. When I was your age, not that long ago, I remember when I was in youth group, that was something that was super, super beneficial and so important for me in my life. So it's so awesome that all of you could be here today. I know that when you have junior high and high school, sometimes it can be, you can have harder times dealing with things, things around you, the world around you. And I remember when I was your age, when I was in youth group, and I would struggle with some of those things, harder times, worldly things, that I could rely on my friends in youth group and my leaders that led us in youth group, rely on them to kind of figure out this life. And so super awesome that you're here today. Our next song is Stand in Your Love, and I think the theme of it especially for you guys too. Like I said, when you try and go through those hard times in your life, navigating, you know, high school and we have a God who loves us so much. And so no matter what fears you have, his love is there for you. So just something to think about as you sing this next song. And we're so glad you could join us here this morning.
Darkness tries to roll over my bones, and sorrow comes to steal the joy I own. Brokenness and pain is all I know, but I won't be shaken, 'cause I won't be shaken. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. To hide, I'm not a captive to the lies, not afraid to leave my past behind, 'cause I won't be shaken, I won't be shaken. 'Cause my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. There's power that can break off every chain. There's power that can empty out a grave. There's resurrection power that can save. There's power in your name. There's power in your name. There's power that can break off every chain. There's power that can empty out a grave. There's resurrection power that can save. There's power in your name. There's power in your name. 'Cause my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. Standing in your love. Standing on the rock. Standing in your.
that you love us, how you love us. Thank you for the way you have made us. We were created for your pleasure, for your presence, for the glory of your name. Thank you for the way that you love us. Jesus, faithful King, Lord, with grateful hearts we sing. How great is the love, how great is the love of our Savior. Thank you for your grace.
Find your seats. As Stella and Peyton get ready for a song, thanks for being here today. It is Youth Weekend, as you've heard already, and we're delighted to have youth with us. I want to talk about that for just a minute. But first, music, if we let it, music reaches into our souls in ways that words can't. Now, you pay me a lot of money to give words, so I'm still going to do that. But I hope that when we worship, we're not just watching it, and not just watching our awesome worship team or watching the words and thinking, oh, when's that song going to be ending? But you're entering into the flow of the Holy Spirit through worship. This morning, there are always lyrics that jump out at me. I'm a lyrics person. I think lyrics have meaning, and meaning touches my soul. And when the music and the lyrics go together, it's very powerful. And this morning, they were jumping out at me. How's this for an opening line? When darkness tries to roll over my bones. Whoa, man, we get bombarded all the time about with evil and self-centeredness and so forth, and that's kind of darkness coming over us. And yet God's love speaks to that and pushes that darkness back. How about, my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. And when Lauren reads the scripture in a few minutes, it's all about God's love for us and our love for God. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your... So what that means is when you have fear and anxiety, let God's love be what speaks to that. Say, you know what, God, I know you love me. There's strength there. Let that strength speak to that fear. How about thank you for the way you've made us? There are people in our culture struggling with who they are and how they're made. And so that phrase, that's a powerful phrase. Thank you for the way you've made us. You might say thank you for the way you've made me. Every person, that's why in our purpose statement, we exist to unite everyone, not everyone, everyone, because the emphasis is on the person. Each person is a soul being. Each person is created as a soul being. So if you're wondering who you are, how you're made, let your soul get in touch with the soul maker and give thanks that he's made you that way. Anyway, a lot of cool stuff. So this is Youth Weekend, and I had a flashback this morning while I was watching the youth come in. They're sitting here in the front row, front couple rows, and I flashed back to when our kids were in the youth group. We had contemporary worship at that time at 8:30 in the morning. Is that kind of early for you guys, 8:30? Is 10 o'clock kind of early? No? Okay, so 8:30 in the morning, and there was a group of youth, looked a lot like you guys, and they'd roll out of bed probably at 8:25, walk down the bike path to the church, and get there at about 8:30 or 8:32, sometimes in their pajamas. And one of the girls who came without her parents, by the way, she came because a couple friends invited her. She came and she had on these big bunny slippers. Okay, cool. Yes, you're clapping, which is fine. You know what? They were there. Their attendance was better than a lot of people who were church members. And so so Catherine wore the bunny slippers one day, and afterward, I heard this, well, can you believe they're there in their pajamas and their bunny slippers? Hey, they're there, and we love these kids, and let's be Christ in action for them. Fast forward a few years later, Catherine, of the bunny slipper fame, started singing in our worship team. Peyton's singing in our worship team. I'm not saying this is going to happen to you, Peyton, but a few years later, we hired Catherine to be our youth director. How important is it to invest in the lives of our youth? Incredibly important. Catherine came without her parents just because a friend invited her, and people poured love into her and others, and she ended up being a youth director. That's powerful. Here's Peyton and Stella singing Brokenness Aside.
Another, caught up in words tangled. Today's scripture is from 1 John chapter 4, verse 7 through 21. My beloved friends, let us continue to love each other, since love comes from God. Everyone who loves is born of God and experiences a relationship with God. The person who refuses to love doesn't know the first thing about God, because God is love. So you can't know him if you don't love him. This is how God showed his love for us. He sent his only son into the world so we might live through him. This is the kind of love we are talking about. Not that we once upon a time loved God, but that he loved us and sent his son to sacrifice, to clear away our sins and the damage they've done to our relationship with God. My dear, dear friends, if God loved us like this, we certainly ought to love each other. No one has ever seen God, but if we love one another, God dwells deeply within us and his love becomes complete in us. Perfect love. This is how we know we're living steadily and deeply in him. And he is in us. He's given us life, from his very own spirit. So we've seen ourselves and continue to state openly that the Father sent his Son as Savior of the world. Everyone who confesses that Jesus is God's Son participates continuously in the immediate relationship with God. We know it so well. We've embraced it, heart and soul, this love that comes from God.
God is love. When we take up permanent residence in a life of love, we live in God and God lives in us. This way, love has the run of the house, becomes at home and mature in us, so that we're free of worry on Judgment Day. Our standing in the world is identical with Christ's. There is no room in love for fear. Well-formed love banishes fear. Since fear is crippling, a fearful life, fear of death, fear of judgment, is one not yet fully formed in love. We, though, are going to love, love and be loved. First we were loved, now we love. He loved us first. If anyone boasts, I love God, and goes right on hating his brother or sister, thinking nothing of it, he is a liar. If he won't love the person he can see, how can he love the God he can't see? The command we have from Christ is blunt. Loving God includes loving people. You've got to love both.
Thank you. So I kind of knew it was coming. I've been through this scripture several times, and I thought, you know, I wonder how many times the word love or loved is in that scripture. So I was trying to count as Peyton and Lauren were reading. I lost track. I can't count that fast. 29, did you count? Oh my gosh, 29. And there are some great phrases in there. If you don't love people, then you're not doing religion right. You're not doing faith right. You're not doing Christ right. And that's the world has a mistaken view of love. More about that in a minute. And we have a mistaken view of faith things. This scripture is where it starts. And love flows through it all. So if we're doing faith in such a way that it's causing hatred between people, we're not doing it right. Maybe inciting a decision, sure, but not hatred or animosity between people. And that's part of what's been going wrong with religion for a long time. Practicers of religion and faith have been doing it in such a way that it's negative and hurtful and wrong. And so that's why I'm doing this series on Religion Stinks. Religion doesn't really stink, but a lot of people think it does, and so we're trying to show a different side of it. So this is our second in the series. Last week was about I don't need the church, and I got to thinking about that this week, and that there are a lot of people who have that exact phrase in their minds. I don't need the church. I don't need to go. And you know what? If going to church is what it's all about, then yeah, we don't need it. But it's like I was trying to say, it's not about you. You don't have to, but where else do you go to get connection with the body of Christ? Where else do you go to get the Spirit flowing? And if you're paying attention to the Spirit flowing, what's that Spirit going to call you to do? Connect with his body. It's right out of 1 Corinthians 12. And that's, I love that because it says if you're a hand and you try to disconnect from the body, what happens to the hand? It dies. It's no good. And he equates that with the body of Christ. So it's not that I don't need to go to church, but you know what? We need one another. Our souls need soul interaction with other people, and our souls need to connect with the Holy Spirit. And that all happens in the body of Christ. That was last week. So why didn't I say it in a minute and a half last week, right? Okay. Anyway, so this series is based on what's happening in our world today, and that is religion has taken a whole lot of incoming missiles from all sides about being obsolete, irrelevant, harmful to people, which breaks our hearts. It ought to break our hearts. It does mine. It's no secret, and we got to be upfront about it. Yes, we've made mistakes. Yes, Christian people have made mistakes. People of faith have made mistakes. Sometimes even bad mistakes, and it's hurt people. We got to own up to that, ask forgiveness for it, and do differently. On the other hand, the people who want to cancel out religion altogether because of some mistakes, that doesn't make a lot of sense. And I tried this last night, but there wasn't much. I don't know if they weren't listening or what, but because I thought this was a wonderful analogy. Canceling out religion altogether because some of it's bad is kind of like wanting to cancel out baseball altogether because the Cubs had a bad century. Thank you. All right. Taken on the whole, religion has added so much to the world, you can't even calculate all the good it's done for people. Talked about this last week a little bit. Hospitals, higher education, most of that was prompted by people of faith, and so on. On the other hand, religious abuses have wounded people badly, sometimes races of people or categories of people. And when we do it that way, we're doing religion wrong. So the problem is not religion, it's us and our sin. So those are just cases of religion gone bad. And if we're doing religion right, then we become a sweet aroma to people around us, which is what we talked about last week. Excuse me. So today's message is, I don't believe in that God either. We've all heard this a lot, and maybe not everybody, but if we're paying attention, we hear this going on in society. I don't believe in a God who sends people to hell. I don't believe in a God that lets people get cancer. I don't believe in a God that allows kids to get abused, and a thousand more like that. In the next few minutes, I'm going to try to offer what I hope is a helpful way to respond when we hear those kind of things. Because oftentimes what happens is we kind of cower. People come at us with, I don't believe in that kind of God. And we're like, oh, what am I supposed to say? And I don't know how to do it. And we end up doing nothing. But hopefully I'm going to give us a chance to respond to that in a good way. But first, let's cover a couple things. One is this. There's a basic question that goes this way. Is there a God at all? In my experience, a lot of people are wrestling with that question, struggling with that question. Is there a God? Does God exist? And part of that question comes from this attitude that is this. If God is like that, like those people are showing, I don't think I want to believe in that God. That's going on a lot. And that we got to own up to that and understand that our witness about who we believe God is and how God is huge for the people that are asking that question. Is there a God at all? And if we're expressing a God that's critical, judgmental, harsh, unforgiving, vengeful, then they're not going to want to believe in that kind of God at all, and we can't blame them. So here's a couple of statistics that just made my eyes pop out of my head almost. In the year 2000, 22 years ago, not all that long for some of us, 2000, approximately 63% of the people in the United States claimed to be actively practicing religion, some sort of religion, not just Christianity, but religion. It could be Buddhism, Judaism, Muslim, whatever. 63% actively participating. Another almost 30% claimed some kind of religion, but were non-practicing. I was surprised that was only 30%. But anyway, and approximately 8% of North Americans at that time, 20 years ago, claimed to be atheist. There's no spiritual world. There's no God. There's nothing like that. It's just physical, and that's it. So in 20 years, in 2020, the percent of active practicing religious people had fallen to about 35%, 63 to right around 35% in 20 years. Let that sink in. Actively practicing religious people fell to about 35%. Whoa. And the number of reported atheists in those same 20 years went from about 8% to about 25%, tripled. So whether we want to deal with it or not, the truth is we're losing ground. Religion is losing ground. But don't despair, because I don't believe we'll ever get to a completely anti-religious society. Why do I believe that? Because you can't stamp out truth. And every culture that's ever been on the earth has had some kind of religious practice. There's something inside our souls that longs for connection with the soul maker. So I believe you can't stamp out truth, and I believe the spiritual world is real, it's true. If it weren't, then humanity would have stamped it out long ago. And believe me, people have tried for centuries to stamp out religion. It's not right, it's not true, it's not there, everything's physical and that's it. They've tried to stamp out religion at every turn, and it always fails. Why? Because truth bubbles up. And we could spend hours debating whether there is a God or not, we need to move on from that, because if you're here, I'm guessing you believe God exists, or at least are open to the idea. But I got a story that's going to kind of hopefully move us past that question of whether God exists or not, at least give us something to think about. Those of you that were here last night, when I get to the punchline, you shout it out, okay? Got it? Remember? So it turns out that there were a couple of scientists, and they had dedicated their lives to creating life. That part's true. That's ongoing. People are saying, how can we create life? You know, we have test tube babies and so forth now. And so after many years, they finally did it. They created life. So they somehow got a hold of God, and they challenged the Lord Almighty. And they said, ha! We know how to create life. So you, God, you're obsolete. You're irrelevant. Humanity doesn't need you at all. So there. Oops, sorry. So God was listening and then said, okay, hey, well done. Bravo. Good job. How about if we have a duel? Let's each start from scratch, create life. I'll do it my way. You do it yours. Does that sound okay? The haughty scientists, some of the smartest people in the world, were very confident about their intelligence and their ability, so they said, sure, Let's do that. God says, okay, you go first. So one of the scientists reached down, scooped up a bunch of dirt, and started to get to work. But as soon as he scooped up the earth, God broke in and said, whoa, 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 stop right there. I guess not that many were here last night, or maybe not listening. Yeah, you get your own dirt, God said. We think we're really smart and we can do away with God, but you know, there's always more. Okay, so think of that context, get your own dirt in this scenario. And we did this a few weeks ago about the Big Bang Theory. So the Big Bang Theory has a lot of religious people all on Twitter, and they think it's this big lock and horns. It has to be either or. I disagree with that. But anyway, a lot of people think that the Big Bang Theory shows that God doesn't exist. I disagree with that. I'm not at all bothered by the Big Bang Theory. As I've said before, I love science. I think all religious people should love science, good science. Most of us in the religious field, not all religions, but most religions, we love science. We love the medical field. We take medicines. We rely on it. We understand the wisdom and the education that comes through that, and we embrace that, right? Well, good medicine is science. Why would we embrace one and not the other? So anyway, here's how you put the brakes on the God's not there discussion. The Big Bang Theory states that at the beginning of time, but then the question is, well, what was before that? So at the beginning of time, all the matter in the universe was in one place in an extremely dense state. And then it heated up and expanded. And because the theory of relativity is true, remember Einstein, as the matter expanded, it formed into stars and planets. Okay, that's what they're stating. It's not a problem. It's just like the story of the scientists who thought they could create life, but then they forgot about they had to get the substance from somewhere. The Big Bang Theory depends on what? Substance coming from somewhere. At the beginning, it was all together in one place. Where'd it come from? Those are the God questions. It came from somewhere. So let's move past the argument, is there a God or is there not? I'm guessing that all of us here or online are here because we either believe that or at least we're open to it. Now, let's talk about what God is and is not. First, thank you to several of you who responded to my Facebook question this past week about what kind of God you don't believe in. A lot of good answers, very good answers. I'm not going to go through them all. Here's a couple. I don't believe in a God who's cruel. I don't believe in a God who turns his back on any group of people. I don't believe in a God who allows people to starve, who allows abuse, and so on. Those are good answers. And when a lot of Christians hear those kind of comments, we back off and we clam up. We don't know how to answer that. So I stopped by today to give us an alternative or give us an answer. Here's a surefire number one way to respond when someone expresses criticism about the God they don't believe in. Let your eyes get real big, let your jaw drop. Body language is important, right? Lots communicated by body language. Let your eyes get real big, your jaws drop, and you say this, "That's so cool. I don't believe in that God either." Stop. You can do that, right? I mean, you could practice it on your way home. "That's so cool. I don't believe in that God either." Let them chew on that. Then after a pause, or next time you see him, whichever it is, you can come back with this. "Yeah, you know what? I don't believe in that kind of God." Maybe you might say a God who sends people to hell for not believing the right things, whatever the answer is. But then you say, "So I'm curious. You don't believe in that kind of God. What do you believe about God?" That's not pushy. That's not arrogant. It's not abrasive. It's questioning. And I hope you're questioning. We want to have a conversation. What do we believe about God? God's still a mystery. God's still to be explored. "Yeah, I don't believe in that kind of God either. I'm curious. What do you believe about God?" You can do that. You don't have to have a PhD in religion to do that. We can all do that. They may or may not answer. They may think you're weird and go away. That's okay. They may have not thought this through. They may not have an answer. Because it's real easy to say, "I don't believe in that, I don't believe in that, I don't believe in that." But what we need to do is help people say, or help people answer, "Okay, what do you think? What do you believe?" And they have to trust us enough, because we're decent at relating, to know that we're not going to bite their heads off if they say something that might seem strange. Anyway, so if the conversation continues, they turn back to you, and there's the member that's like, "I don't believe in that kind of God," you say, "I don't believe in that kind of God either. What do you believe?" They might turn that back to you and say, "Well, what do you believe?" And And that's when you are ready with some kind of phrase like this. I believe in a God who loves me even when I'm unlovable. So that's the beginning of understanding grace. I believe in a God. You don't have to make some kind of great, brilliant expose on the attributes of God or whether God's there or not. Just say, you know what? I believe in a God who loves me when I'm not lovable. That's what Scripture says. Romans 5:8 was when we were still sinners, God proves his love for us through Christ Jesus. So, and then the hope is you can have a conversation, not a lecture, but a conversation about what it means to be loved even though you don't deserve it, even though you're unlovable. And there's a word for that, and I've already mentioned it. It starts with a G. Everybody, what is it? It is grace. Thank you. I can die happy. All right, instead of arguing about God's existence, instead of trying to reason people into believing, instead of trying to convince them, let them taste grace. Because that taste will stir in their soul and will start to thaw their hearts. Instead of presenting a case about existence, how about letting them taste what it means to be loved, even though you're unlovable? Any definition you give about God can be argued against. Any reason you give can be countered. Any evidence you use can be twisted. But grace is weird. Grace is hard to argue against. Grace is the one thing that people aren't prepared at all to deal with or respond to because it's otherworldly. Grace is the love of God we've been given that we don't deserve and can't do enough to earn. By the time I die, move, or retire from Pekin First, I hope everybody in Pekin First can let that roll off your tongue. Grace is the love of God we've been given that we don't deserve and can't do enough to earn, yet we still have it. You're loved that way. Now, how do you respond to that kind of love? Do you want to serve? You want to love in return? So grace is what was flowing when Jesus hung on the cross, dying, having been murdered, in the process of being murdered, and he said, remember, Father, forgive them. He's talking about his murderers. Father, forgive them. They just don't know what they're doing. That's grace. That's the one thing that has any chance of changing people's minds and hearts because it gets into the inside, gets into the soul, and it stirs and it stays. It works from within. So, when people say, I don't believe in that kind of God, agree with them. You don't believe in that kind of God either. And when the door opens, you can say, I believe in the kind of God who loves me even when I'm unlovable. And I've received that love and I'm trying to live by it. Something like that. Hard to argue with that kind of grace. It'll kind of confound them. And we're not here to argue people into faith. We're not here to reason into it. We're here to let them taste the grace of God, which has been real in our lives, hopefully, or soon will be. And we share that because grace is what changes people. So part of the problem is when we're thinking about God, we tend to want to see God as how we want to see God or how we think God should be. We tend to make God in our own image. And here's an example of that. One of the first responses on Facebook when I put out the question was this. I don't believe in a God who's cruel. Okay, cruel, we need to understand that, you know, your perspective is important. And we think of these bad things happen to people, that's God being cruel, and we don't believe in that, so we shy away from it. But I agree, I don't believe in a God who's cruel, but I think we gotta have to look at God from a different perspective. Because that phrase triggered a memory in my mind of Tony Melendez. We talked about him a couple years ago. Tony Melendez was born with no arms. Think of it, born with no arms. But he grew up to play the guitar. How do you play the guitar with no arms? With your feet. He grew up and was asked to play the guitar for the Pope. Now, we're not under the Pope, but, you know, Pope is a strong religious leader in our world. And he got asked to play the guitar for the Pope at a massive youth rally in Denver several years ago. And remember the story he told of being a little boy sweating on the dirt floor. What happens when you sweat on the dirt floor? Mud, right? And he's trying to get his T-shirt off with his feet because he has no arms. He's crying and he's screaming, he's rolling around, getting muddy, and it's getting worse and worse, and he's just trying so hard. And his mom standing by watching. The aunt walked in and screamed at Tony's mom and said, "What are you doing? Are you heartless? You got to help him." And she bent down to take off Tony's shirt, but Tony's mom stopped her and said, "No, I am helping him." Was Tony's mom cruel? Was she unloving? Was she heartless? No, she was helping him. Do you think he would have grown up to play the guitar and be asked to play in front of the Pope if people had just removed his shirt for him? And yet we want God to do that for us. If things go wrong, if things are negative, we're like, God, why'd you make me do that? Why'd you make that happen? We got to understand there's a little different perspective. When we try to make God into, or try to envision God into how we want God to be, how we think God should be, we need to think, you know what? Maybe that's backwards. Maybe I need to figure out who and how God is and align my life that way, as opposed to having my life how I want it, how I see God, and I want God to do for me what I think God ought to be doing for me or for us. We've got things turned around. Got another story about this. In 1992, I was the coordinator of the district youth ministry. This district is a bunch of Methodist churches all together, and we sometimes would do things together as youth in that district. We'd have events and so forth, ski trips, concerts, whatever. Youth came from different churches in the district to these events. So one day, my heart broke and I got really mad when I got word that one day, two of the girls who'd been attending our youth events had been in Jacksonville nearby. They were 17, they were driving home during the day. During the day, driving from Jacksonville to Murrayville, 15 miles, I don't know, not very far. And a 20-year-old kid who was very drunk at the time, during the day, 20-year-old kid, very drunk at the time, crossed the highway line, hit the girl's car, killed them both, he walked away. I'm still very upset about that. What do we say when stuff like that happens? I don't believe in a God who'd allow girls to get killed. Whoa. How about this instead? Society, that's us, we'd better start looking at what we're modeling for our kids when we'd allow an underage, irresponsible juvenile choose to get drunk. By the way, somebody got him those booze. Think about that on your conscience. We need to rethink how we're modeling when we allow kids to do that, to choose to get drunk, choose to get behind a wheel, choose to drive at a high speed and kill somebody. Oh, boys will be boys. That's not God's fault. Human sin is a big problem. It's not God's fault, it's ours. We've got things turned around. We think that God should be the way we want God to be and think God should be and run the world the way we think it should be run. It's backwards. This is God's world. His spirit, his mind, his heart is above all. We need to get into that flow and do it that way. And if we are doing religion in a way that's harmful, that's causing pain, causing abuse, then we're not doing it wrong. We're doing it right if we abide by what Peyton and Lauren read to us. Love is of God. Everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. But if you don't love, then you don't know God. And if you say you love God, but you hate your brother or sister, you don't know God, because God is love. Those are powerful, powerful words from Scripture. So what kind of God do we believe in? We believe in that kind of God that was read in the Scripture this morning. Who could argue with that kind of God? And if we're plugging into that kind of love of God, and our souls are soaking in the Spirit of God, and we're receiving the characteristics of God in our life, and we're letting that flow outward, who could argue with that? Hard to argue with love and grace, but it's great to experience. When we're saying we don't believe in a God who allows sickness, death, hypocrisy, abuse, and so forth, we'd be far better served if we paid attention to the people we are. People who are sinful, who mess up, who harm others. It's not God that allows war. It's humans that choose it. It's not God that's causing people to starve. It's humans that are allowing that to happen because we don't share and we're self-centered. It's not that God's causing people to die on highways. It's that people choose to be self-centered and choose to do whatever they think feels good and break laws and people end up dead. That's not God's problem, not God's causing. It's not that God allows people to abuse others. It's that people are selfish, self-centered, and they choose harm for others. And when we do, we're not doing faith right. We're not doing religion right. We want a perfect world where there's no sickness, no harm, no cancer, no division, no outcasts, no poverty. Well, you know what? It did exist at one point, but it all got messed up. Check out the first few chapters of Genesis. It'll tell you all about it. What happened? Sin and disobedience caused all the problems. So it boils down to this. We rant and rave about the kind of God we want or don't believe in. We're probably trying to define God according to our image of what and who and how we want God to be. That is backwards. Let's start here. Either there is a God or there's not. If there is, then as the creation, we had darn well better be figuring out how to enter that reality, the reality of God, and doing it God's way, and living God's way, instead of trying to get God to do what we want God to do or we think God should do. We better be adjusting our attitude, our lives, to bend to God's will, as opposed to getting mad at God when our prayer isn't answered as we think it should be. Several years ago, I was at a different church, and the pastor gave a message, and I got this illustration from him, and I didn't get it perfectly, and it's online, you can go look it up, but it goes something like this. Jesus is talking, and he says, "You call me friend, but you don't spend time with me. You call me Lord, but you don't obey me. You call me teacher, but you don't learn my ways. You call me Savior, but you don't trust me. If I condemn you, don't blame me." Now, still, we might argue about God who condemns and so forth, but think of it this way. If you ignore God all your life, if you do your own thing, do whatever you want to do, life gets messed up, and then you say, "God, where were you?" God might be saying, "I've been trying to tell you all along, where were you?" If you've been frustrated at the things you see God allowing or doing or not doing, then maybe it's time to go back to the drawing board and erase the thinking about God that tells you that God is supposed to do things your way, the way you want, the way you see, and the way that makes sense to you. Instead, go back and open up your heart and mind to receive the God whose nature is this. "I know they're killing me. I know they're wrong. I know they're sinful. I know they're pretty much unlovable. But please, Father, give them grace as you've given me grace." That's kind of a reworking of Jesus' words on the cross. "Father, forgive them. They just don't know what they're doing." That's grace. That God, God of gracious love, is real hard for people to ignore, criticize, come against, discount. Because gracious love is who our God is. And grace is what changes people and will eventually change the world. Let's give up our self-will, our desire to self-determine, and let's let God know we're ready to conform to his world, his way. Thank you, O great God, for this time together. Please, we ask forgiveness for how we ignore you all of our lives. We do our own thing. We try to create life the way, or try to see life the way we want it to be, and then we blame you when stuff goes wrong. Help us understand the haughtiness of that attitude, the self-centeredness of that attitude, and help us, O God, to remember that this is your world. The world needs to be your way, and it's best when it's done the way you've shared with us in the scriptures. Love, sacrificial, gracious love. Help us be that kind of people in the world today, so that other people who are questioning you, who are frustrated with you, they'll see grace, they'll experience grace, they'll taste it, and they'll want more. In Jesus' name we offer ourselves. Amen.
Morning, everybody. My name's Kara, and I'm the youth director here. And we're just excited that the youth are here to help do the service today. And so they're not going to be excited about this, but I'm going to ask all of the youth to just kind of stand up. We have some up front. We may or may not have some in the booth back there. We have some in the balcony. We have some in the audience. So everyone stand up. Just kind of let them see your faces. We have some back here. So all right. So we handed out cards with some of the kids' faces and some information on them. And what we're asking is for you guys to take those home, hang them up on your fridge, hang them somewhere. So that way, throughout the year, you guys can look at those and pray for the kids and help them to grow. So with our youth group, we have fifth grade through high school. And we have kids that have grown up in our church. We have kids that have come just because a friend has invited them. We have kids that have strong faith. We have kids that are questioning their faith and aren't sure. They really kind of come for the food or the fun. But what's important is that they're here. And so one of the things with the youth that I think a lot of people would say, and I would agree with, is that the kids don't always listen. They're fidgeting, they're talking like they are now. But the secret is they really are listening. They're getting more than what we think. An example of this is we went to a Winter Extreme, a winter church camp this year. And at that time, we would do like a worship time, and then they would do a message with us. And then after that, our group, like our small groups, would go and we would talk about the lesson. and then we would be done. And then we'd go and have fun. Well, after one of the times, one of the youth volunteer or one of the adult volunteers that came with us asked the kids a question about something that had happened, and nobody answered it. They all just kind of looked at each other, and he said, "Okay, the first one of you that answers this question, I will buy something from the gift store." And how quickly did they all suddenly know the answer to that question? And the person that ended up doing it is a child that wasn't growing up in the church. And actually, the answer was something I didn't even know the answer to. It was a detail. And so I know that they weren't listening fully during the worship because I watched them. And so what we need to know, what we need to take from that is that the kids are hearing us. They are seeing us. And it's our job to help them grow. And the way that you guys have given to the church through your offerings and your tithes and stuff like that has given us the opportunity to take the kids and do some of these things. And so we just really appreciate all that you guys do. And so we have a quick video here just to kind of show you all of the things that our youth have done throughout the last year because you guys have been generous to help us out. Thank you.
Over the last year, our two youth groups have grown friendships in a Christian community through things such as youth group lock-ins, Six Flags, Cunningham's Children's Home, local outings, and more. Because of our church family that love and support us. Thank you.
Hello, church family. My name is Kira, and I'm here today to talk about what our youth group is going to be doing this summer. We love our church and we love our God, and we are going to be showing that by partnering up with charities such as Twigs and Figs, Midwest Food Bank, and more. But wait, our youth group is going to be doing fun activities as well. Church camp and an eventful day at Six Flags. If you could help in any way, that would be greatly appreciated. Thank you for letting me speak.
Thank you, youth. And you'll get a chance to stream to the altar and give your gifts in just a moment. My mom didn't grow up in church until a neighbor girl invited her, and she experienced love there, which she wasn't experiencing in other places. And she's like, "I want to be around those people. I guess they were that sweet aroma that the Bible talks about, we talked about last week." And that invitation from that little girl to my mom changed an entire family. Brought her dad back to the Lord, who eventually became a pastor. American Baptist pastor. I've got Baptist blood. And I'm forever grateful for that invitation. We have youth, kids, children and youth who aren't growing up with parents who are in the faith. How important is it to invest in them? Greatly. I spoke about love, gracious love, and there is hardly any better example. Jesus on the cross is the best one. The one I'm going to talk about now is the next best. Jesus gathered for the Passover meal. It's a big celebration for the Jewish faith. It was a Thursday night, and he had the Passover meal, and all 12 of his disciples were gathered, even Judas. Now, a lot of you have heard that every time we do communion. Some people are here for the first time and have not heard that. Even Judas was sitting there with the 12. Jesus invited him to be part of the group. Judas had already sinned. He had already betrayed him. And Jesus knew that, and yet he still offered him grace. That's powerful. Not supposed to be like that, but it is. And that's the kind of love, when we are attached, connected with the Lord Jesus Christ, that's the kind of love that flows out from us, and it gets in people, and they're like, it's not supposed to be like that, but it is. I'm experiencing that. It's truth, and it's love, and it's power, and it's goodness coming through. So he took the bread of the Passover meal, he gave thanks to God for it, then he broke it, and he passed it to his disciples and said, this is my body, broken for you. Eat this in remembrance of me. So when we eat the bread, we remember God's love for us through Christ Jesus, who gave himself up sacrificially, completely, to give us love. We've received that love. Now we share it with others. After supper, he took the cup, gave thanks to God for it, and said, this is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for all for the forgiveness of sin. All of you drink this. We need to pay attention to that phrase, all of you, because all of you included Judas, who had already sinned, as I said. That's powerful love. That's gracious, sacrificial love that the world does not have, does not know, does not get, except from our God. Thank you, O great God, for this time of communion. We ask that by the power of your Holy Spirit, you would bless these elements, this bread and this juice, so that they'd be filled with your grace, so that as we receive them, we receive you, we receive your grace, and our lives are changed, and we move towards you. We receive your love, and we share it. In Jesus' name we offer ourselves. Amen. In the United Methodist Church, communion is open. If you're here, you are invited to share communion with us. We don't make distinction based on age, based on understanding, based on economic factors, based on membership. If you're here and you seek life in Christ, you seek the grace of God, then you can come and receive grace. We do ask you to come by the middle aisle, pause at the altar as long as you'd like, return by the side aisles, and use this time of communion to let your soul connect with the soul maker. We'll be ready in just a moment.
To you. clear your promise, my soul now to stand. So what can I say? What can I do? Offer this heart, oh God, that we lay to you. So what can I say? What can I do? Offer this heart.
Explore our faith without your support. Amen.